Wouldn't you know it, that as soon as I say that I'm going to be doing a regular book review, I run out of time to do much reading. However, I am reading again and enjoying it again. So today I'm going to look at this book, and I love this. And I'm going to do this in a few parts because it's just so full of astonishing information that I want to get through it. Well, A, because I want to read other books at the same time, but B, because it's so full of information, and we'll make a few different videos. This video is literally just about a tiny little part of it, but I've got to talk about it because it's so mind-blowing. And the book is Scared to Death, From BSE to Global Warming, Why Scares Are Costing Us the Earth. I'll talk just about one of the most significant parts of the first section of this book, which is the health scares of the 80s and 90s. And it goes into great detail about Edwina Curry and Salmonella in the 80s. I'm sure some of you will remember this. But apparently, I've taken some notes about this. Apparently, she'd said, and I quote, most eggs were affected by Salmonella. When in fact, according to this, the total number of Salmonella cases officially linked to eggs amounted to a mere 26. Now, in general, this most eggs was based on flimsy science at best. Curry used, as politicians often do, people who would back up what she was already saying. They were, when we were investigating eggs, were looking only for the Salmonella within eggs. They weren't looking for any other causes. It was confirmation bias, basically. And it tells me, and this is hardly a shock, but that politicians will take sketchy science if it suits them, and if it suits them to scare people, which is what this book is all about. Scaring us, and scaring us for what purpose? Scaring us for greater control. And what you'll see through this book is that the more the media does the government's bidding, and no, I'm not talking about any crazy conspiracy. The media will blow up these healthcare food scare stories. Public becomes frightened. In comes the state to rescue us, and to rescue us with masses upon masses of regulation and, of course, taxes. Never forget taxes. So, following the egg scare, more and more food scares came throughout the 90s, so that we ended up with an army of environmental health officers or bureaucrats, or what's the other one? The clipboard warrior. That's the one I'm looking for. And it led to absurdity. So I've got to tell you a couple of basics. This one was from Warwickshire. And this was a Warwickshire GP reported a case of four people with food poisoning. And they had become ill after eating a meringue. And the eggs from that meringue were traced back to a local convent. And the nuns in this convent, headed by an 82-year-old, rather sprightly lady, were issued with an infected place notice, and were told that their 2,500 chickens would have to be slaughtered. So when the officials came to kill the birds, the nuns wouldn't let them in. This made global headlines. Global headlines. I don't actually remember this. Maybe some of you do, but according to this book, it made global headlines. And it turns out that the whole thing was essentially scientifically wrong, that the strain found in the nuns' chickens was different to the strain of Salmonella found in the people suffering from food poisoning. But regardless of this, and regardless of the fact that it took 2 months for the local busybodies to connect these eggs to the nuns, so within that 2 months they had still been selling their eggs, and there wasn't a single other case. But all of that, even taking all of that into account, a team of vets, police and world press turned up to kill the birds, even though they'd sold 12,000 eggs in the space of time without a single repeated case. So throughout the 90s, we had an army of bureaucrats, as I say, health and safety officers, going out there, frightening people, and with the opening line, and again it says this in the book, this is mind-blowing, you've got to read this book. They would go in to, and as they did, to a lady named Dorothy Wood, and she had a bakery, a small bakery in Bolton, and the clipboard warriors turned up at her bakery, telling her, opening quote, "I have the power to close your business." Don't you love it? Just imagine a little government bureaucrat coming into your shop and saying, "I have the power to close your shop." Wow. So Dorothy was summoned to a magistrate's court to answer criminal offences. And here's what she had done. Who was what they listed as her sins? Having a bucket of water in the shop. Now, Dorothy explained that she was cleaning the floor at the time that the clipboard warrior arrived. She was cleaning the floor with her bucket of water. Keeping a box of butter in the same fridge as sealed meat. I'm not sure. I know I'm not an expert on this. I know sealed or raw and cooked meat can't be kept together. But I'm not sure that keeping a box of butter in the same fridge as sealed meat is necessarily a catastrophe. And one of her sideboards was chipped. Her court hearing lasted 2 days and she was fined £2,000. And we go on. There are other ridiculous examples. But what was happening was that these bureaucrats were coming into small businesses, and largely because of directives from the European Union. But of course, we choose how to put those directives into practice. So I have no doubt, and particularly, of course, towards the end of the 90s when Labour were in government, I have no doubt there is an enthusiastic public sector, bloated public sector, going out there and telling small businesses that they had the power to close their business. And it led to, what it was always going to lead to? Closing down small businesses. People couldn't afford to keep up with the ridiculous demands. And I'll give you one example. This takes us into another area, which I mentioned a little bit about earlier this week, which is slaughterhouses. I mentioned this in the animal welfare policy video that I did earlier in the week. Slaughterhouses closed their doors. Now, get this. This is an incredible statistic. In the space of 4 years, more than half of Britain's slaughterhouses were closed because the meat hygiene requirements and regulations placed upon them, as I say, largely from Brussels, but I'm not letting the UK government get away with this. They were clumsily applied, these directives, for a start. Coming from Brussels, you know what the ultimate aim is, which is major, every aspect of life, regulated and controlled. And guess what that means? Massive state power. So you know that the EU isn't exactly against it. But small farmers and butchers paid a massive price for these regulations. And there was an example, Tom Chamberlain, and he had a slaughterhouse right next to his butcher shop. And that to me, if you're going to do meat, that to me is how to do it. Nowadays, of course, because we have, we lost more than half of the small slaughterhouses in the country in the space of 4 years, but we have massive factory abattoirs. And of course, as you would expect, the animal welfare aspect of this has gone completely through the floor. So Tom Chamberlain had a butcher shop and a slaughterhouse right next to it. The bureaucrats came in and told him that no, you're not allowed to carry the meat from the slaughterhouse to your butcher shop. You have to build a refrigerated tunnel between the two. Not only that, but you also have to build showers and rest areas for drivers who come and go from your business. And this is despite the fact that drivers who would come and go from his would be within 5 miles. It's very local stuff. He weighed it up and decided that he couldn't afford it. So this business had been in his family for over 100 years. He couldn't afford to go along with these absurd impositions from the state that he had to close his doors. So this is small business under assault. And the effect on certain things, the effect on consumer rights, I think. And I think this year I want our party to focus a lot more on consumer rights, because you can feel this happening across society. It's almost the call centre culture, isn't it? You pay for something, you don't get it, or you get it and it doesn't work. You phone up, you have to wait 10 minutes to get through to the... You have to press several different buttons and then you can't get through to anyone. And everyone knows how frustrating this is. Yet the one thing that never goes wrong with these big companies, you have to call their call centres and wait 10 minutes. The one thing that never goes wrong with them is them taking your money. That part always works out. And it's really disempowering and frustrating that the consumer at the end is left feeling that I've paid my money and I'm not getting what I paid for. It's a disempowering experience and it disempowers people in society. And I think that's a serious issue. And the reason it's small business is better for the consumer is because small businesses will want your business. You tell a massive company like Sky that you're going to take your business elsewhere, they're not going to care. Really not. They may try and talk you back for 5 minutes. But in reality, they have millions of customers, no doubt. And they're not going to be frightened by you taking yours away. The effect on the consumer, as I say, is obvious, but also the effect on the community and the high street. And, you know, we all like our familiar brands, our 008 Smiths and things on them, boots on the high street. And it's we like our brands. Of course we do. But I also like private, small businesses to flourish on local high streets around the country. And I think that is good for the local economy. I think it's good for local people. I think it's good for community. It's a good thing. It's a positive thing to have a thriving high street and with small businesses on it. We, For Britain, is our policy to give tax breaks to small businesses so that we can give them a hand. Also parking break, lowering or getting rid of parking charges, for example, so that people can go out to the high street again without paying a fortune for parking. So a priority for us economically. And remember, the economy is still, small business is still the backbone, is still the majority of the economy. And I'd like to see us go back in a direction of small business, community and customer service. So once again, fantastic book, Scared to Death. I will go through several other parts of it. So we'll get through this over time. Next week, a member wrote in and asked me to review this book, Unveiled by Yasmin Mohammed. Yasmin, if you happen to watch this, do get in touch. It would be great to talk to you. We, of course, have chatted before. I think we did a podcast, your podcast, a couple of years back. It'd be lovely, lovely to talk to you again. Congratulations on this book. And I'm going to try and get you on for a podcast. So Unveiled by Yasmin Mohammed is next week. And I'll get back to more from that Scared to Death soon. Take care.